all persons having business before the Honorable Associate Judges, now presiding over the District of Columbia Court of Appeals. Draw near and give your attention. God save this United States and this honorable court. This honorable court is now in session. Please come to order.
Good afternoon, everyone. Welcome to the District of Columbia Court of Appeals Zoom oral argument. We have one case on today's special sitting calendar. It is In Re J.F.S. number 21-FS-449, and we will hear first from counsel for appellant respondent.
Thank you, Your Honor. Good afternoon. May it please the court. Julie Swaney on behalf of appellant J.F.S. I would like to reserve 3 minutes for response or rebuttal. Appellant J.F.S. was stepped back to a secure detention facility, the Youth Services Center, on July 1st, 2021, after having spent 4+ months in full compliance in a community-based shelter home placement. The trial court judge, Andrea Hertzfeld, made the step back decision solely based on her finding of J.F.S. being involved as an aider and abettor in very serious offenses, the top count being first-degree murder while armed.
Ms. Swaney, can I ask you, I just want to make sure I understand your position about the district's argument that even before your client was stepped back the July 1st order, that your client already was being detained within the meaning of these provisions. Is it your position that your client was already being detained? Or do you think that your client's prior status was something other than detention, like shelter care?
So, Your Honor, I will hope to give you a direct answer, but because the statute is somewhat confusing, I'll just take a moment to explain our position. We do believe that youth shelter house is a form of detention that exists under 1623.10. Shelter care, as described in the statute under Section B of 1623.10, encompasses the neglect and PINS proceedings that allow for detention and shelter care for other purposes, most importantly now, the dangerousness to the respondent himself, which cannot be something determined in a delinquency setting.
Let me ask a question, just I want to be clear about this. Suppose the juvenile is picked up and they decide to put him into shelter care pending a determination. Is that an appealable order? Is that the statute apply?
I'm sorry, Your Honor, if I could just understand.
If at the time that he is, I won't say arraigned, but I don't know the correct term, but he's seized and they're trying to decide what to do with him before you have your probable cause hearing, and or even after the probable cause hearing, and he is put in shelter care. He's not committed to YCS or whatever it's called. The statute applies or not, doesn't apply?
I think the statute—
I mean, what I'm asking is, I want to be sure that I understand you. Detention includes shelter care.
Correct, Your Honor.
Okay, that's all. I just—
So just at the bottom line for our purposes, although we agree that shelter house or shelter care is a form of detention, it is very much a less restrictive form of detention. And I think that is the main conflict between us and the government.
So when there was last February sort of the step down to the youth shelter house, do you think that was an appealable order?
I don't believe the government has the right to appeal here. I may be wrong on that.
Let's say you, for whatever reason, you thought you deserved release from the Youth Services Center, and instead what you got was youth shelter house. But it was less restrictive than your prior placement. Do you think you have a right to appeal that?
So if we believe that we set forth all of the rationale for home being the least restrictive environment, then yes, I think we could have appealed such a decision. I'll just note, as I know your honors know, we did request shelter house, so we did not take that further step.
Sure.
Let me ask this. Do I correctly understand that in shelter care, he was able to visit his family on weekends? That has been changed. Now he cannot visit his family. He must stay there. Is that an appealable disorder?
Yes, Your Honor.
It's certainly a change in his status.
It is a change in his status, and it is also a more restrictive on his liberty interest. So just going back to the difference between shelter house and YSC, there's an enormous gulf between those levels of restriction, even though they are both forms of detention.
Can I ask you though, I'm still a little puzzled about a third variable. So I understand your position, I think, that youth shelter house is a form of detention. I thought I heard you say a minute ago, and I just want to follow up and make sure I heard you correctly, and if so, understand why you said what you said. I thought I heard you say that you think shelter care generally is a form of detention. Well, did you say that, or did you mean to say that, or what do you think about it?
So, Your Honor, this is where it becomes a little confusing for my purposes as a delinquency attorney, given that shelter care and that sort of term of art is used for neglect proceedings mostly. So I don't know whether the court in neglect proceedings considers that a form of detention as opposed to just a respite for the child.
Are you saying that you think shelter care is not an available option in a delinquency, an available statutory option in a delinquency matter? Well, I didn't remember seeing the statutes that way, but I may have missed something.
Sure. And this is where I don't mean to muddy the waters at all, and I hope I am being clear. Shelter care is used, again, in neglect proceedings and PINs, and we believe is equivalent to shelter house for delinquency proceedings.
Part of what I'm puzzled about, I guess, is, I thought shelter care was a statutory option in delinquency cases. Is that incorrect, or that is correct? Is it a statutory option?
The reason I'm hesitating, Your Honor, and I want to give you a straight answer, but the reason I hesitate is because shelter care in the statute allows for a provision for a child to be detained to protect themselves from themselves, essentially. And that is not authorized in the delinquency context. And so that's—
Let me ask it more simply. You may have a complicated answer, which is, although some of the provisions seem to make shelter care an option in delinquency cases, for complicated reasons, either it doesn't operate, it has to operate in a special way, or maybe, taken as a whole, the provisions should be read to foreclose it. But at least on their face, do the statutes seem to authorize shelter care as an option in a delinquency matter?
Yes, Your Honor, I would answer
And are you familiar with the statutory definitions of shelter care and detention?
I am, Your Honor. Don't know that I have them right in front of me, but I know that detention is considered a fully secure facility. I'm actually, detention is defined as the temporary secure custody of a child in facilities designated by the division pending a final disposition of the petition.
And do you think that the conditions at youth shelter house meet that statutory definition? Is it secure custody of a child in facilities?
No, Your Honor, it is not
secure. Okay. And the definition of shelter care, which is the immediately next definitional provision, so part 14 of 16-2301, says the temporary care of a child in physically unrestricting facilities. Do you think youth shelter house is a physically unrestricting facility?
I do, Your Honor, I'm sorry. I
That's fine. No, I think the district takes those positions too. So it sounds like whatever other points of disagreement there are, and there are a number, that if I'm picking up on things correctly, both you, for purposes of how we should analyze this case, it seems as though you and the district both agree that during the period when your client was at youth shelter house, your client was detained within the meaning of the statute. And the order that is at issue in this case changed the circumstances of your client's detention to a different place that is more restrictive, I think that probably isn't gonna be disputed either. And the issue is how to interpret the statutory provisions in light of that understanding. Is that fair in terms of your understanding of how we should be looking at the case?
Yes, Your Honor.
Thank you.
Talk about the merits a little. Hey, can you just, you know, in a couple of sentences, remind us your argument on the merits. What was inappropriate about this detention?
Yes, Your Honor. So because JFS had no incident reports or other rearrests or anything of that nature that a judge might look at and say a more secure level of detention is required here, instead Judge Hertzfeld, solely because she gave her findings in the trial that she found JFS involved as an aider and abettor in, a very serious charge, first degree murder while armed, as well as the other counts in the petition, except for count two, that was the sole basis. That just,
I mean, it's a pretty big one, counsel. You know, one day, presumed innocent, probably didn't do this murder. I can't hold, you know, I can see the trial court saying, I can't hold somebody based on that. He's been good in the institution. We'll give him a more lenient placement. And then the next day, well, found him guilty now, find that he had committed a murder. That is an enormous change. It's not, I mean, it seems like you want to gloss over it. Why do you think that's not a significant change in the calculus?
So I don't mean to gloss over it, Judge Steele, but I don't believe that there is any rationale or ability for a judge to solely, in the delinquency context, make a placement change that significant from shelter house, which is less restrictive, to YSC, which is more restrictive, solely based on what essentially was an implicit presumption that dangerousness had increased just by nature of a beyond a reasonable doubt finding.
Well, why doesn't it seems like it almost, as a matter of logic, increases danger. If there's some danger, if the trial judge is thinking at the time of the original detention, and also at the time of the original step down to youth shelter house, you know, I'm weighing danger. And when I weigh danger, I look at it as a case where there's a substantial probability that the respondent committed a dangerous offense, but you know, it also may well be that he didn't. So that's one side of the danger calculus. And then there are other considerations on the other side. And the trial court then, after making the findings the trial court did, seems to be, as a matter of logic, facing a higher risk. If there was some risk when you thought there was a substantial probability someone committed an offense, then once you say, I know beyond a reasonable doubt that the defendant committed this dangerous offense, wow, well, that has got to logically ramp up the concern for safety on that side of the equation. So I don't see why you would need, it needs a lot of, that part of it needs a lot of explanation. It seems to follow almost as a matter of logic.
Well, Your Honor, I mean, we would disagree because in the juvenile context, the actual determination of involvement does not equate to punishment, for example, at disposition.
I don't think the line of questioning I was, or the line of reasoning I was attributing to the trial court is a punitive one. It's one that says I'm assessing risk. And one of the main parts of my earlier assessment of risk has, changed in a way that is, makes me very concerned about danger. That's not a punitive rationale. Well, that's a protect the community rationale.
Well, Your Honor, we believe that the record that the respondents demonstrated during the 4 months in a less restrictive environment of the shelter house did not create any additional basis for step back. So I appreciate the court's logical sort of inference that the trial court could have made that danger now exists, but it's not actually based in any reasons that the respondent himself had already been successfully engaged in community services for 4 months prior to the finding. And so there is, in our view, no actual justification, particularly because no presumptions apply like they do in the adult context following a verdict.
Well, can I ask you about that? Why do you say no presumptions apply? If your view is that 2328 incorporates 2312 and 2310, then why isn't there, after the adjudication of involvement, still a presumption of dangerousness? Because that is sort of a fortiori from the presumption that was created at the time there was a substantial probability finding for this type of offense.
So we don't believe a new presumption asserts itself. So obviously the presumption was in place when JFS was seen in JM 15 in 2020. He was detained based on that presumption, and the court found substantial probability and that the presumption had not been rebutted. When Judge Hertzfeld stepped JFS down in February, that presumption no longer applied, or at least she found that it was rebutted enough to allow JFS to go to a lesser form of detention, the shelter house. And so—
I see, I think I get your theory, which is the presumption applies, but it had previously been rebutted and nothing changed to allow the trial court to decline to find it rebutted. And I guess what that rests on, again, is the idea that in trying to figure out whether the presumption is rebutted, the trial court can't take into account, well, now that I have found beyond a reasonable doubt that the respondent was involved in this very serious offense, it would have to be a pretty remarkable showing to rebut the presumption. And is that your argument, is the trial court couldn't reason that way?
Yes, Your Honor, without something that says that the least restrictive, which is required under the statute, the least restrictive placement for JFS was not still appropriately the shelter house, that there had nothing significantly changed from JFS's perspective or behavior that demonstrated that he was unable to continue in a least restrictive level of detention.
Let's say that this was an appeal at the probable cause stage. The trial court said, counsel, I'm going to detain your client because I think beyond all doubt he committed this murder. So he's dangerous as can be, and I'm going to detain him. I suspect you'd be arguing before us that violates the presumption of innocence, and the trial court shouldn't have been making statements like that. It was the trial had yet to happen. And that it would be wrong for the trial court to do that because it treated as your client as being more dangerous than merited given the stage of the proceedings. And if that's true, then it strikes me that it must be wrong to think that now an adjudication of guilt can't massively change the calculus. So what am I missing?
Well, Your Honor, I don't believe that that would have been our argument out of JM 15 because the rebuttable presumption, I mean, certainly the language of the court would have been concerning, but I don't know that we could have demonstrated at that time that the rebuttable presumption had been rebutted. The difference here is that Judge Hertzfeld determined in February that there was a least restrictive form, lesser form of detention that was required in order to meet those prongs of community safety or specific safety of individuals or property or risk of flight by the respondent. And so again, even if respondent had been held at YSC this entire time, I don't think we would be here today. I think the main difference is that Judge Hertzfeld gave the respondent an opportunity to demonstrate that he could thrive in a less restrictive environment. He did so. And so there was—
Can I ask you— Well, go ahead, Jeff.
This is real world. Suppose we say the trial court didn't explain well enough why she decided to move him to a slightly more restrictive type of confinement. What it seems to me your argument essentially is she had to leave him in shelter care because originally she decided to leave him in shelter care What if she just said, I've changed my mind. I think I should send him to shelter care in the first place. I mean, what is she supposed to say beyond what she said? I've changed my, the reason I'm doing it is because he now has been convicted. And previously it was just a probable cause kind of situation. I'm not clear whether you're saying she must leave him in shelter care or whether you're saying she didn't explain enough. And if it's the latter, she didn't explain enough, what more is she gonna say beyond what she said already?
Which is
doing it because he is now a convicted murderer.
So in this,
I mean, I don't get it. I don't know what you want us to do.
So in this particular case, we would argue the former that JFS must remain in shelter house because nothing was demonstrated by his conduct, behavior, any rearrest, any abscondences, anything of the nature that normally requires step back or allows step back by a trial court judge.
But a discretionary decision, isn't it?
I apologize.
People with discretionary decisions can change their minds, can't they?
Well, not just arbitrarily, and we believe that this was an arbitrary.
It's not arbitrary. There's been something's happened.
Well, in the context of at least my practice in delinquency court, the trial court judges make their findings about detention and the level of detention based on the behavior of the child and not necessarily the charges that are at issue. And I'll just give a very brief example. I had a first degree sexual assault trial last year where my client was convicted. He had never been detained because there had never been a probable cause hearing on that. But once he was convicted, then that could have engaged 1623.10. And yet he was doing so well in the community and at home that the judge did not find that she had a basis to detain him. And so again, it's a different circumstance here in terms of this client was at shelter house and there had been previous probable cause and substantial probability finding. But delinquency court judges have to engage in some analysis as to whether they need to securely detain someone at such a high level of restriction. And again,
counsel, part of your answer seems to be wrapping around to the second half of Judge Sedman's question, which is the judge ought to have explained more, at least. I know your position is there was only one right answer on this record, which was continue your client in the less restrictive placement because he had been doing well there. But assuming I do think you seem to be making an alternative argument, which is in any event, there should have been some better explanation. And I want to make sure I understand, I guess, first, exactly, if you think further explanation was needed, what it ought to have looked like, in particular, what findings you think the trial court was required to make. And to be specific about that, you've referred to least restrictive alternative, and you've referred also, or we've discussed a little bit, the criteria in 1623.110, which aren't necessarily exactly the same. They seem pretty similar, but they're not necessarily exactly the same. Which do you think governed the trial court's decision here? Do you think the trial court was required, in order to make the decision that it made, to make the findings required in 23.110, or do you think those weren't required, but what was required was a least restrictive alternative analysis, or both?
Thank you, Your Honor. So I think that it is both. So when the court determines that detention is required at either level, shelter house or secure detention, the court should deliver findings.
Just to be clear, shelter house is a form of secure detention even. It's just less secure, is that right?
No, Your Honor, I would not agree that it was secure detention. It is,
because I thought you said shelter house fit the statutory definition of detention, which was temporary secure custody of a child in facilities.
No, Your Honor, I'm sorry. When you asked, as you read part, I think you read part of the shelter care definition.
Well, I read both, yes.
Okay, yeah. That shelter care is distinguishable because it's just staff secured. It's not a physically secured.
I'm not using the term shelter care. I'm asking you about shelter house.
Yes, Your Honor. Shelter house is also physically unrestricted, just like shelter care is. So it is not the same, and that is not fully secure like YSC.
That seems to me different from my understanding of your answer earlier when I thought there was agreement that shelter house is detention and that what happened here was only a shift in detention. But you're on further reflection, or maybe I misunderstood your answer, but your answer now is you think that your client's placement in shelter house was not detention, it was not secure custody, it was physically unrestricted detention, and thus would have fallen within what in the facially would fall within the statutory definition of shelter care. Is that your answer now?
Yes, Your Honor, and I apologize if I was confusing. I was trying to distinguish through the definition that shelter house does not meet the definition of detention under Title 16 as a fully secure facility. We do agree that it's a form of detention, just like we believe shelter care could be considered a form of detention. But again, I don't want to keep mixing up shelter house versus shelter care here. And I'm sorry, Your Honor, you had another question that...
I think you answered it, which is to say you think that the trial court was required both to find that the prerequisites of 23-110 were met and also that this particular form of placement was the least restrictive alternative. And yes. I have a follow-up question about that, which is just, I don't really see any place in the trial court when it got to be time to argue about what the post-adjudication placement of your client would be, where the argument was made to the trial court either, wait a minute, before you step back my client to YSC, if I'm getting the acronym right, you need to make some findings you haven't made, and you need to do some explaining that you haven't done. Was there any reference in the trial court to least restrictive alternative or to having to make new findings about 23-110 and its prerequisites?
So, Your Honor, I'm just very quickly reviewing the argument there. I did not ask for specific findings under 16-23-10, that's correct. I solely described that the nature of the offenses had already been contemplated and that the court had already stepped down JFS to shelter house. And we did not believe that he should just be stepped back due to the findings that were made and then referenced obliquely, admittedly, but that the juvenile system is not like the adult side where you're automatically taken back to jail. Trying to say, but did not say explicitly to the trial court that no presumption had asserted itself.
Although, is it your view that there is or isn't a presumption? You thought the presumption existed and then was rebutted, and although maybe it still exists as a technical matter, nothing had changed, so the trial court was required by law to treat it as kind of pre-butted.
Well, so we don't agree that there is a new presumption that arose just because the findings were actually made. So the presumption existed at the time of arrest and when the petition was heard in JM15. The presumption at that time was not rebutted. In February of this year, Judge Hertzfeld, we believe, accepted that the presumption had been rebutted, at least in terms of the level of restriction on JFS. So again, reducing that level of shelter house. And then that according to the statute, no new presumption arises just because there is a finding of guilt.
Why do you say that? If you think that it's a new detention decision that the trial court was making on July 1st, and it's subject to 23-110. And this is in your view, a placement in detention prior to a dispositional hearing. So it's governed by 23-10A. And then 23-110A-1-11 says there shall be a rebuttable presumption that detention is required. So if this is like a new determination being made under the statutory provision, why I don't know, I'm not sure about new and old, but when the trial court was making that determination on July 1st, wasn't the trial court required to say, oh yes, there is a presumption in the picture here? Now, maybe the trial court would have to go on and say, well, it's rebutted because I already found it was rebutted and things have only been good since then. I understand that line of reasoning, but it seems to me like the presumption is applicable. In your view, I think the district might have a different view that none of this is applicable, but in your view, it seems like the presumption would be applicable.
Well, because the adult system actually explicitly creates a presumption after someone has been convicted or enters a plea of guilty, that the detention calculus changes and a new presumption is made, that is not the same as in juvenile court. And so my point is that there is no presumption in the juvenile statutes that comes into play after a finding is made. And so I think that's the distinction.
Well, there's no special different heightened one. Right. That's true, if that's your point. My question, I guess, is it seems like the one that applied at the pre-fact-finding hearing stage continues to apply at the post-fact-finding predispositional stage.
And perhaps that's a better way of saying it, Your Honor. Thank you. Yes, that the court seems to have imposed a heightened presumption here just based on the findings and did not consider the other factors that we believe need to be analyzed in order to make specific detention findings, particularly secure detention at YSC.
Well, I you're over your time. Unless my colleagues have other questions, we'll give you your 3 minutes in rebuttal after we hear from counsel for the district.
Thank you very much.
Mr. Sasser, you may proceed.
Just waiting for the clock. May it please the court, I am Samson Schatz for the appellee, the District of Columbia. Before I get into some of our arguments, and I would like to touch upon the jurisdictional argument that we make in our brief, I'd like to clarify a few things. Number one is JFS has been in detention pursuant to 162310A-1 since April 2020. The question before this court is not whether JFS should be detained, but rather in which facility he should be placed. Number two, the decision to step down JFS to shelter house did not involve rebutting the presumption within the meaning of subsection A1 or A-1. That transfer was still detention. The presumption that JFS should be detained is still in place, and there is no new presumption. It's the same presumption. And third, shelter house is unequivocally a facility in which a juvenile can be detained. It falls within Judge McLeese's question, it falls within the meaning of the definition of detention from section 162301.13, which says temporary secure custody because it is considered staff secure. It's considered a staff secure facility, whereas YSC—
I mean, you have a footnote to that effect that cites to some general correctional document that I haven't looked at because I'm not entirely sure whether I should be looking at it. And I don't know whether it relates to, I assume it's not specific to this particular facility, youth shelter house. I assume it just is kind of laying out some general definitions. That was my inference. But if this is critical to the resolution of the case, how are we supposed to know what the conditions were at youth shelter house, whether it is or is not detention within the meaning of the statute? I mean, that would depend on kind of what the conditions are, you know, what the restrictions and operation of youth shelter house are. And we don't know anything about that from this record. Not anything, that's too much. We know very little about it.
So I apologize that citation was to kind of a general handbook and we didn't provide one for the principle that shelter house is a detention facility. But I think I think it's fair to say that there's a consensus within the juvenile justice community, both from defense.
Well, again, we generally are limited to the record to decide appeals rather than, I don't know if you want us to take judicial notice of your representation about the consensus of the community. But if this ends up being outcome dispositive, I'm just not sure we'll have the factual information that we need in the form we should have it to decide the matter.
So let me explain why it's not actually in JFS's interest for shelter house to not be considered a detention facility. Just to clarify, you know, there is the term shelter care in the statute that is governed by a different subsection, subsection B of section 162310. And that pertains to, that is a service that exists when a juvenile lacks supervision in certain contexts. Shelter house.
But before you move on to the contrast, is it your view that shelter care, as that's defined statutorily, is in certain circumstances an appropriate, permissible placement for a juvenile in a delinquency matter?
I think the answer to your question is yes, insofar as shelter care does sometimes play a role in delinquency matters. In Ray KG, the individual was not detained prior to the order that was appealed in Ray KG. He was released to the custody of his grandmother, but at some point that was no longer sufficient supervision and he was placed in shelter care. But shelter care is different than detention.
Well, I found in Ray KG very confusing about that because it seemed like it might've been referring to the youth shelter house. Because there's a place where it looked like there were these capitals and it says youth shelter house and it has brackets around it. And so I actually found NRA KG quite confusing about the relationship between youth shelter house and detention and shelter care. It's pretty clear that the court in NRA KG was treating the option that it was in front of it as shelter care as opposed to detention in the statutory sense of the term. But maybe you can clarify things, but I found in Ray KG pretty confusing on this topic.
So I think it's possible that what's going on here is that there are facilities that serve both purposes, both detention in a staff secure sense, but also shelter care, which again is a different term than detention within the statute. But let me again explain why, or for the first time I didn't before, why it's not in JFS's interests for this to be considered shelter care. The reason is that subsection A-1 attaches a rebuttable presumption when a substantial probability that certain crimes were committed by JFS. Presumption attached back in April 2020. So we are operating in a post A-1 world in which JFS is detained. So in February, when the judge stepped down JFS from YSC to shelter house, if this court comes to the conclusion and if JFS is arguing that shelter house is no longer an appropriate detention facility, then that order was unlawful. And then this order that's before you now is this issue is like kind of moot or it goes away somehow because there is no option to step JFS down to shelter house because that is not an appropriate placement for an individual where there is a rebuttable presumption that detention is required.
Hey, can I just ask a question about this threshold issue? There is a right to an interlocutory appeal under 2328, even if somebody is released on condition, right? That's what the case is.
Correct. That is one of the four options, yes.
And so what if somebody is released on condition? And the condition is stay with your grandma. Other than that, I'm fine. And then a week later, the judge says, you know what? I changed my mind. You're going to stay with your grandma, but the conditions are you are not to leave that house. You are not to access the internet. You are not to contact friends or family, et cetera, et cetera. You think they still have a right to appeal even though they are still just released on conditions under the statute?
Your Honor, I think no. I think that would be a similar situation.
No right to even so the statute that provides you a right to appeal if you're released on conditions would give you an initial right. Maybe he's happy to stay with his, at his grandma's. Maybe he doesn't want to appeal. And then he's put under draconian measures. He's waived. He's abandoned that statutory right to appeal by not appealing the thing he was happy with, even when it was stepped up tenfold.
The situation, I don't know much about, how conditions are placed, so I don't want to go too far into that category, but I will say what you are describing sounds like a clear abuse of discretion and an appropriate application of a mandamus.
I'm not saying it's an abuse of discretion. She might have had totally good reasons to put all those conditions on. What I'm saying is, when you've got a statute that says you get to appeal even a release on conditions, when you have a significant change in the detention or release conditions, that seems to be what's animating this right to appeal under the statute, not sort of a technical version of, is this a quote unquote detention under the statute? I mean, that's the point I'm getting at.
And I understand your point, Your Honor. If you'll let me kind of go a little bit back to the detention order, I will say that in In Re KH, this court said clearly that a reconsideration motion of a detention order was not a detention order within the meaning of 2328A. And so I think that if
I don't know that it follows from that conclusion. Which would, again, if Judge Steele's hypothetical had been somebody is put under a condition of release, doesn't appeal it, files a motion to reconsider that condition of release, it's quite clear from In Re KH that that would not be viewed as, the denial of the motion to reconsider would not conceptually be viewed as subjecting somebody to conditions of release. So far, so good. But it seems quite different. And if we're just shifting for a minute, so it doesn't seem like it's governed by the outcome or the circumstances of KH. And if you're looking at the text of the provision, it says a child who has been ordered detained. You don't think on January 1st, JFS was ordered detained?
On July 1st? No, Your Honor.
Why not? Isn't it, the order says go to a secure facility and stay there.
Because
why is that not an order detaining him?
Because he was already detained. He's been detained since April 2020. The placement of his detention has changed.
But, and its duration, in the sense that, there was an order under certain circumstances and people are saying to the judge, now make a decision, detain this person or not. Or detain this person in one place rather than another. Judge issues a new order. The order operates to detain the person. It supersedes the old detention order. I mean, if you're trying to figure out what is the legal authority requiring JFS to remain in YSC and YSC to hold it, where do I go to find that authority?
You mean as opposed to a shelter house?
I'm just saying.
Or in general.
If somebody says to you, okay, I'm trying to figure out what the legal authority is for YSC to be holding JFS right now.
Mm-hmm.
Where do I go?
The answer is unequivocally A-1.
No, I mean what order?
Oh,
I mean the statutory authority. I mean what order is the judicial act that permits YSC to securely detain JFS?
I think that you really would need to look at the findings and the proceedings that occurred on April 23rd, 2020, because that's when the statutory factors were investigated and found that justify his detention. And those aren't found every time a placement is reasserted. And I think that if they were, then that would be that would kind of support the theory that you're teasing out, that this is that each change in placement is a detention order, but we're already operating under the legal decision that was made and come to the court came to on April 23rd, 2020.
Can I ask why this matters? I mean, we have said both in KH and JEB before it, which KH distinguished, either way, this is appealable. A motion to reconsider is appealable, what we said in JEB. So it's just a question of whether or not it fits under the statute. I think it's 16, 23, 28, like, if I'm getting that right. or whether or not it's otherwise appealable as a sort of as a final order. What difference does that make?
So, with all due respect, Your Honor, I think this actually is different from your previous cases, because I think there are three options here. One is to proceed under 2328 with the less than a week timeline or an appeal. We don't think that's proper, as we've been discussing. The other option.
I just mean we're already here, so
keep... fair enough. But surely, what you decide today could be precedent for the future. And also, there is a distinction between an expedited appeal and an emergency appeal. Now, part of the kind of damage of the emergency appeal, and I don't mean to disrespect the process at all, has already happened with the tight timeline. But you all are required, if you find that this appeal is properly brought under 2328.
But why doesn't this fit squarely under emergency appeals under Rule 4 C2? And then C2, expedited appeals. There's expedited appeals. It's not limited to government appeals from pretrial orders, et cetera, but then you get to emergency appeals and it says pretrial or detention appeals, juvenile interlocutory appeals. Doesn't this fit much more comfortably under that language? I mean, I guess we could parse it and say this is technically not pretrial, bail, or detention because it's juvenile. It's not technically a juvenile interlocutory appeal because we treat this as a final order, but it sure seems to fit within the gestalt of 4C2A and not the expedited.
And I'm sorry, Your Honor, that I'm not familiar with 4C2A, but I will say, just going back to that third option that I haven't yet mentioned.
Oh, I'm sorry.
No, that's fine. We don't think this is a final order. The rules of this court said before, if 2328 doesn't apply, for example, in Ray KH with the motion for reconsideration, if 2328 doesn't apply, the court will still look at it because it is a final order. Because we don't think that this is actually detaining, taking JFS from not detained to detained, we don't think it's final order.
I gotta ask you, we made it a point in KH to distinguish JEB, which was a 1973 case. Do you have a distinction of that case? Because JEB was a denial of a motion for reconsideration where the person was already in detention. I think I'm gonna pull it up and double check, but if that's right, are you familiar with that case? Do you have a distinction of it?
I don't think I am ready to discuss that case in detail. I thought it was announcing a new rule that perhaps virtually overruled that.
But. KH says, and I'm just pulling up the language here, that it makes it quite clear that what we said in JEB, that it does not fit within the statutory language of denial of consideration, but that we treated it as I'm trying to see if I can find that exact discussion. Oh, never mind. I'm not thinking of KH. I'm thinking of KG.
In Ray DEJ, I think you made
DEJ, that's it. I keep saying it wrong.
Sorry. Right. Yes, I know that case.
That one.
That case, Your Honor, is the court held that a late filed appeal of a detention order. I think it was within a month. So it wasn't filed within the 2 days to get the kind of emergency procedures under 2328, but it was a late filed appeal of that detention order. And the court said, that was a final order. The court likened it to a pretrial bail order, and that was the same thing. That was the same kind of logic that the court applied in Ray KH to a motion for reconsideration of a detention order. But the key distinction between all those three types of orders is that they take a juvenile from not detained to detained in a way that this order is not. It is simply changing.
I'm looking at DEJ, and it was an appeal of a motion denying a motion to reconsider the detention. It is not taking somebody from not detained to detained. It was saying no reconsideration. Now, I guess you might say, but it was still within the time in which they might have appealed the initial decision, and so we should treat it that way, but it seems quite at odds with us being quite clear that
we were considering an appeal from a denial to reconsideration.
Fair enough, Your Honor. And I'm happy to move to the merits. My understanding of DEJ was that it was a late filed appeal of the order of detention. And again, I still think that an order of detention, a pre-trial bail order, even a motion for reconsideration of a detention order are distinct in the sense that they are taking an individual from not detained to detained, and the liberty interests that are you know, changed and altered there are distinct from JFS's case, where he has been detained since April 2020 and the placement of his detention is merely changing. But even if this court's not convinced that—
just to follow up, I think you already answered this question, but to be clear, Judge Deal asked you some hypotheticals about changes of conditions of release. And at least some of them were in the context of whether there was an emergency appeal right. But I think you did ultimately take the position, I just wanna make sure I understand the scope of your position, that those, a hypothetical order like Judge Deal was describing is just not appealable at all. If a trial in a juvenile delinquency case, if the trial judge initially imposes a very minimal condition of release and no review is taken, and then the trial court imposes, you know, much more draconian, debatably legal, but maybe not mandamusably illegal conditions of release, your view is there's just no jurisdiction over such an appeal. It's not a final order. It's kind of more of the same category and is just not reviewable. Am I right that it's not only not an emergency appeal, it's just not review, an ultra emergency appeal under 1328, it's just not reviewable at all?
Again, Your Honor, I'm unaware enough of kind of the release conditions and how those work that it's, I could imagine the scenario being different. You know, you apply one condition and now we're applying more conditions. Is that falling under the statute, under the text of the statute 2328, you know, in subjecting the individual to, release conditions? But you can't be, you know, if you're detained, you're not more or less detained, at least I don't think within the meaning of the statute. There, you know, you are detained under A-1, and it is the judge's, we believe that is squarely within the judge's discretion to determine where the juvenile is placed for that detention.
I mean, the determination about whether to detain the respondent at all is a discretionary ruling also, or do you disagree? Do you think we reviewed de novo a trial court's determination, this, you know, I have a respondent who's not detained right now, I'm going to issue a detention order or not? To make a ruling under the relevant standards. When we review it, don't we review that as a discretionary ruling?
I think that yes, an appropriate amount of deference should be given to
is the fact that it's a discretionary ruling where to place the child in particular forms of more or less restrictive forms of detention, if that's what we have here, which appears to be disputed. Why is the fact that that's discretionary, how does that bear on whether it's reviewable?
How does it bear upon whether it's reviewable?
I thought you were arguing you shouldn't review, you know, we shouldn't be in the business of reviewing trial court determinations about where to detain juveniles. That was the gist. And I thought you were saying you shouldn't be in the business of doing it as discretionary. And where I ran up a ground on that line of thinking was, well, a lot of what we're reviewing here is discretionary. So why is that a reason why we shouldn't get into that, to reviewing those determinations?
I apologize, Your Honor. I think I was trying to shift a little bit to the merits, and it might've made me sound like I was blending the two, but I don't mean to do that. I think you're right that the factual findings pursuant to 2310A-1 should be reviewed by this court with deference, and for many of the same with deference. But here, this case is different, and this the placement order is different, and the review of it is different because there aren't legal standards within the statute to review or to nitpick.
Why do you say that? I mean, we said in NRA KG that, in, you know, when trial judges are making determinations in this area, they need to, I forget the exact wording, I can pull it up, gotta wrap in, take account of the statutory purpose that includes the least restrictive alternative analysis. So although you know, as an original matter, I guess one might have argued that that language wasn't really operative as a test and instead was just kind of a hortatory piece of congressional or legislative policy. We seem to have taken a different view in NRA KG. Do you know the language I'm referring to in NRA KG?
Yes, but I think NRA KG is distinguishable from this case in two very important ways. One is the order that was being reviewed there was taking an individual, a juvenile, from not detained to detained. And so that requires—
Right, just focusing on the first, I mean, the language, I'll see if I can pull it up again, but I think the statutory language that we quoted and that I think we italicized was at all times. Am I missing that?
I think that the key point, Your Honor, in the way that the purpose provision was used in NRA KG is in the way that purpose provisions are legislative purposes are you know often used by courts, which is to construe specific text, statutory text. It's not used as a free-floating guideline or even as a, you know, rights-conveying
language. Again, as an original matter, that would be a, you know, a better set of points as an original matter, but just back to the language of NRA KG, we said the statute seeks to achieve the foregoing goals in the least restrictive settings necessary with the preference at all times for, you know, dot, 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 dot. And then we said the goals apply to all phases of a juvenile delinquency case was the next sentence. And so I sort of saying, well, that was a special rule for orders that shift from non-detention to detention. I mean, do you think it applies to conditions of release? Do you read NRA KG to mean that if a trial judge is asked by the government, impose seven conditions of release and the defense says no, just one? You think when a trial judge is making that determination, the trial judge is required to take into account the obligation or the statutory purpose of achieving the statutory goals in the least restrictive settings necessary?
I don't think that language should be in NRA KG should be read to create a standard by which this court would undo any decision by the trial court. And if all you need is this one sentence, it's also NRA KG court also clearly said that on page 1220, that section A-1, which authorizes a presumption and thus to some extent relieves the government from having to make a case specific showing that detention is required. And I cite that language to juxtapose the world in which KG was operating in, which was a subsection A determination, which, you know, there is a greater burden on the government to prove, to demonstrate that detention is required there. And perhaps those principles that you cited are, you know, are part of that analysis. But again, we are operating in an A-1 scenario in which the presumption attached. And so I don't think that, again, the least restrictive language, you know, operates as a standard by which this court can undo or should undo the trial court's placement order. If there are no further questions, we'd ask the court to dismiss for lack of jurisdiction or to deny the motion or summarily affirm. Thank you.
Thank you, counsel. Ms. Sweeney, we'll give you your 3 minutes in rebuttal.
Thank you, Your Honor. So most specifically, I would like to address the government's claim that this is merely just a change in placement and does not fundamentally alter JFS's pretrial liberty interest. The distinctions, again, between a shelter house and YSC are vast. In shelter house, you attend school where that is in the community where you would go as if you were at home. You are eligible, as Judge Stedman pointed out, for home passes to visit with your family on the weekends. You are engaging in community-based services and providers that can take you to other places in the community to receive those services. At YSC, you are solely detained at YSC. There is no movement. You are not coming out of the facility for anything unless there's a medical appointment. And even then, you're in shackles the entire time. Your room is actually locked every night at YSC.
I guess, counsel, can I get a little uneasy when you, some of the things you've mentioned I can find in the record, like about weekend passes and the like. A lot of the rest of it I don't find in the record. And so I get a little uneasy about if this case turns on actually having reaching some factual conclusions about the nature and degree of restrictiveness of the youth shelter house, then I feel a bit at sea, and I feel reluctant to rely on the representations of counsel at argument or general correctional documents or the like.
I understand, Your Honor, and so I will move on from those factual statements and point the court to DC Code 16-2310, but Section E1 and then A to C. And this is where the DC Council also distinguishes between youth shelter house, youth services center, I should say, secure detention. This is timelines for fact-finding hearings. Secure detention, fact-finding hearings must take place within 30 days. And there are some caveats depending on the seriousness of the charges. But, and again, it says shelter care, but the operation in Superior Court is that it applies to shelter house, that fact-finding hearings are held within 45 days in shelter care or shelter house. We believe that they, in this section of the statute, are one and the same. And so I point that out to say that the DC Council has certainly recognized that there is some additional restriction on liberty interests just based on the fact that they have accelerated the timeline to go to a fact-finding hearing when someone is detained, securely detained at YSC, versus when they have more freedoms in the community and are at youth shelter house. And so if I may just close here and state that this case is not just to overturn a placement because JFS incurred no violations. Instead, Judge Hertzfeld erred in the law in two areas. One, she created a presumption or a heightened presumption, as Judge McLeese stated, for detention just based on her findings. And she had no other findings that were made in terms of anything that JFS did to demonstrate that he was not able to succeed and continue in a less restrictive form of detention in youth shelter house. And so we ask this court to grant appellant's motion for summary reversal of interim detention decision of July 1st, 2021, and to order JFS released to shelter house placement pending his disposition hearing on August 5th, 2021. Thank you very much.
Can I ask a question? The government says that we should dismiss for want of jurisdiction. Suppose that we think it should be affirmed as if it were a direct appeal, apart from the question of jurisdiction. Would that be a proper disposition, or are we forced to decide the jurisdictional issue? In other words, can you say whether or not we have, whether or not this appeal is properly taken, nonetheless, we think that the trial court did not abuse its discretion, or do you run into the problem of jurisdiction because you say, well, the government's position is that it's not even an appealable order? I think that's government's position, isn't it?
So, Your Honor, if I may, I would note that even if this court for some reason determined that this was not a proper appeal under 16-2328, the detention order challenged here is still a clear example of a trial court ruling covered by the collateral order doctrine. And I would point this court to Cohen v. Beneficial Loan Corp. 337 U.S. 541, 1949, the U.S. Supreme Court case, that this court adopted in Stein v. United States 532A2D641 at 643 DC 1987, that an appeal such as this conclusively determines the question of the lawfulness of the respondent's secure detention, and it would resolve an important issue completely separate from the merits of the action, which would be whether the heightened detention was lawful or appropriate. The issue on appeal would be effectively unreviewable on appeal from a final judgment, as no matter how the question of his predisposition detention status is ultimately resolved, even a single day of unlawful detention offends the respondent's constitutional rights. And again, I would just refer to the difference in liberty interest between a YSC person.
Ms. Rennie, can I know we're over time, I think, but I did have one more question that was prompted by something that your opponent said. And I don't think we have a transcript of whatever in-court hearing there was. I assume there was one in, if it's February, is the right time when your client was stepped down to the youth shelter house. But your opponent said, at least the way he was conceptualizing things, that had nothing to do with rebutting presumptions or anything else. That was just kind of moving the detention placement of the respondent. And do you know, I mean, the order that we have doesn't really reflect how the trial court was conceptualizing any of that. Do you know whether when the trial court, you know, in arguments before the trial court or whatever the trial court might have said orally at that hearing, whether there was talk of rebutting presumptions and whether youth shelter house was treated as a different place of detention or instead as a non-detention placement, or are you not sure?
Well, Your Honor, I am JFS's trial counsel, so I was present for the February 9th, 2021 hearing where he was stepped down. I will tell the court just frankly that those are often not the types of language that we use when we're generally requesting step down. And so the short answer is no, there was not explicit discussion of presumptions or whether they've been rebutted, et cetera. There was a service plan that was created by myself in coordination with my client's probation officer that laid out what his day would look like if he were released in shelter house. And certainly the court was aware, the trial court was aware that it would be a quite different level of supervision, that he would not be fully staff secured. But I cannot say that an explicit discussion was made about presumptions or whether they were.
Can I ask you a related question? I haven't gone back to try to check this out. I have the recollection that this was not the first request. The February was not the first request to have your client stepped down to a less restrictive environment, whether you call it a different form of detention or non-detention. Are there written filings that were submitted with respect to earlier requests, or are those again typically made orally at a status type hearing?
Yes, the latter, Your Honor. There are not written requests. They are oral requests. Essentially, the way delinquency attorneys view the court's ability to determine placement level is that at every opportunity, meaning every status hearing, a new request can be made and should be focused on the child's behavior, up to that point. And so it did take several hearings, even back-to-back hearings somewhat in February, to get the court comfortable enough, with the services that were in place to step JFS down. I recognize this isn't all in the pleadings before the court, but that was the process by which the judge ultimately determined his step down to shelter house.
Thank you. Unless my colleagues have any further questions, I think the case is now submitted.
Thank you very much.
This court is now adjourned.